talking with the experts.
And you're right. It's not just professional. The angle of the podcast is professional, but it applies personally. You might have a situation with a neighbor. You might have a situation with a child or a parent that you've been avoiding. And we all have, I'll say almost all of us have conversations that we are avoiding because we don't have the bravery as one of the reasons to do something about it. So, again, I haven't studied it, but my experience both as a professional worker in corporations in America, as well as a leadership coach, everyone I've worked with needs to say something or do something that they have not done. And one of the key factors of that is the absence of bravery to do it.
Talking with the experts.
Hello and welcome to Talking with the Experts. My name is Rose Davidson from rosedavidson.com. And Talking with the Experts is about all things business by business owners for business owners. And you can find it on all good podcasting streaming platforms and on YouTube. And it is my pleasure to welcome back Ed Evarts, because we had a bit of a conniption earlier on this year, and I've invited him back to come. So thank you for joining me again, Ed. It's such a pleasure to see you again.
Thank you for having me, Rose. I am thrilled to be back.
Yeah, okay, so tell me a little bit about your book that you have got in progress or has launched or whatever is going on with it at the moment.
Well, it did get launched. It was launched in September of 2020, right in the heart of the pandemic. And it's called Drive Your Career. And really, it includes 9 stories that I have heard or listened to with client relationships over the last 14 years that seem to come up again and again and again. And whether I'm talking to a company president or a functional supervisor, these behaviors and activities always seem to apply. So I didn't bring them up purposely. They just came up naturally in the conversation. And I began to notice that these stories kept coming up to help people navigate through whatever challenges they were experiencing. And I had a moment that said, hey, Ed, this could be your second book. Why don't you listen a little bit better and see how many stories there are that come up again and again and again. So I did that for a while and identified 9, I call them behaviors or actions or awarenesses that you should have in order to really drive your career, right? So many of us are passengers in our career and we just end up wherever we end up. I believe people should drive their career and know what direction they want to go and figure out ways to get there.
Yeah, okay. So do you want to run me past the 9 steps or 9 stories quickly before, so we can get a gist of what's in the book?
Sure. I'll tell you a few of them. I want to leave some of them as a surprise to encourage people to purchase the book to hear the rest of them. So, the first chapter, and I didn't put them in order, so they are not in order of importance, and they may not apply to everybody. You might read a chapter and say, this just doesn't affect me and apply to me. I'm not saying all 9 stories affect all people. So you might look and say, gee, that chapter looks interesting, or this chapter looks interesting. That said, the first chapter, I did start with for a purpose, and it has to do with having a positive relationship with your boss. And, we just do not spend enough time reflecting and ensuring that we have a positive relationship with our boss. And I would ask our listeners to sit back and potentially on a scale of 1 to 6, 1 being I have a horrible relationship with my boss, to 6 being I have a fantastic relationship with my boss. We finish each other's sentences and, walk together beautifully. Where are you, right? Where are you? And if you're anywhere from a 3 or below, it might be a time to think about how I can have a more positive relationship with my boss. You know, bosses act as a filter to the work that's coming through the organization. They talk about you with others. They are a reflection of you in the workplace. And you want to ensure that if the CEO of the organization says, hey, how's Ed? That the quick snippet your boss provides is positive and future focused and supportive, not critical or negative or, you know, pausing because you don't really know what to say or how to say it. So just having a positive relationship with your boss. And I'm not a statistician, but I began to notice over the last 14 years that easily 85% of my clients wish they had a better relationship with their boss. Some were ones, right? They had a very bad relationship with their boss. Others were twos or threes and even some fours, but they all wished that their relationship could be a little bit better. And so that's why I started with that chapter.
But sometimes, isn't it the boss's fault that the relationship isn't any good? It's not the employee's fault.
Right. And it's not a matter of fault or obligation, but relationships are a two-way street. And so, I can't work to have a great relationship with you if you're not interested in playing. And you're not going to have a great relationship with me if I'm not interested in playing, right? So one of the ideas I share in the book, and this is not easy to do, but if you find an opportunity, is to say to your boss, hey, I believe we could have a better relationship than we have today. You know, are you willing to take steps and work on our relationship? And of course, we hope and expect that our boss will say, absolutely, I would love to do that. There are some bosses that are unmanageable, that are untenable, that are impossible to work for. I can't solve that relationship because I'm not coaching the boss, I'm coaching you. But you've got to find ways to ensure that you can make positive progress with your boss. Some relationships will never get better. Some people need to leave their role or leave their organization because the relationship they have with their boss is so unmanageable that they're just never going to make progress. But for the bulk of us, I believe, and I believe that is the minority, but for the bulk of us, having a more positive relationship with your boss is doable.
Yeah, it's very important to, I guess, have a good relationship with your boss, your manager, your leader, whoever it might, whatever you want to call them, because, it makes for an unpleasant work environment if you can't get on with them. And there's no point really going to work and feeling miserable all the time because you just end up with anxiety and depression.
Yeah, I use the term baggage that, if I don't have a good relationship with my boss, every time we interact, every time we see each other, anytime that we have a one-on-one, there's always this baggage that's weighing me down because I don't have a great relationship with you. Well, get rid of the baggage. And I'm not suggesting that you are confrontative, but there are very subtle ways to say, hey, I'm working on relationships in the workplace. I'd love to have a better relationship with you than we have today. What are some things both of us can do, you and me, in order to improve our relationship? You can even do this with people you have good relationships with to say, hey, we've got a fantastic relationship. I think it can be better. What's one or two things we can both do in order to improve the relationship? Unless you take a step, and I do believe it starts with you. So even if it's your boss who is problematic and hard to work for, the answer does start with you. You have to take the first step and you have to be the one to put the situation or the idea on the table in order to see if you can make great progress. If you don't look out for yourself, if you're not taking steps in order to improve your experience, you're not driving your career. You are a passenger just experiencing what you're experiencing and not taking steps in order to make good progress.
So what's another chapter in your book about?
Another chapter is one I call No One Knows You Better Than You Do. And, this was an observation I had in working with clients in that very few of my clients would take time to be self-reflective and think about, what they want, how they're experiencing what they're experiencing, how they're going to make good progress in whatever it is that they want to make progress in. They didn't take time to think about their next steps, what they want to work on, where they want to go. They were almost like puppets of the company who said, here's where you're going and here's what you're doing and we hope you like it, et cetera. So, no one knows you better than you do. You know yourself better than anyone. And that includes a spouse or a parent or a child. They all know you and they all love you, but nobody knows you better than you do. Nobody knows your strengths. Nobody knows what you like. Nobody knows what you don't like. Nobody knows lies and bad behavior that you've done in the past that you've covered up because you didn't want anyone to know it. You know, these are all things that you know. So it's so important for clients to take some time, and it could be twice a year. It's not weekly or daily, but as long as you have a recurrence of the behavior, to sit back and think about, where am I? Where am I going? You know, what trail is this? What am I on? And am I making good progress? Where do I want to go? Is this the right way? Is this the right company? Is this the right relationship? And what can I do in order to make great progress? People who do that are more likely to drive their career, right? And move in the direction they want. People who don't do this and never be self-reflective and never think about what they want and know are going to be passengers. And they're just going to have to take what they get because they've never declared what it is that they're looking for.
Yeah, sounds pretty right. A lot of people don't think that they know themselves, but I'm sure if they reflected on it, they would know more about themselves than what they think they do.
Well, I think people think about themselves a lot. You know I do. And of course, I can only speak first person. Again, I'm not a statistician, so I've not like studied this numerically. But, you know, I think people, you know, sit in a meeting and a topic comes up and in their mind, they're like, oh, I hate this topic. Why are we talking about this topic? I'm not going to say anything about this topic, right? I mean, so I think they're being reactively self-reflective. What I'm talking about is proactive self-reflection, which is sitting down and even going to a conference room with a whiteboard and, you know, writing down and starting to think about what's important to me, where do I want to go, how do I get there, who do I tell? You know, you can't do it on your own, right? You need partners and mentors and networking connections in order to make good progress. So, you know, I think people do know themselves fairly well, not everyone. So self-awareness for some people is low. And those are people who are very hard to work for. But yeah, I do think people think about themselves a lot.
Oh, yeah, I wasn't sort of, what you alluded to is that people's self-awareness is low. I think that's the point I was trying to make and didn't sort of put it in those words. But you're quite right. There are people that aren't self-aware. And, you know, it's hard to, I guess, find a way for people to work with you if you don't know and you're not aware of your own behaviors.
Right. Right. Self-awareness is my number one objective as a leadership coach. So when I work with individuals one-on-one, my primary goal with them is to help them build their self-awareness so they can self-manage more effectively. If you have very high self-awareness, your ability to interact with others, have relationship with others is significantly greater than somebody who has low self-awareness. If you have low self-awareness, your ability to operate effectively is seriously hampered. And those are people who are very hard to work with. So those might be those bosses you were mentioning earlier that, hey, you know, you're part of this as well. It's not just me, it's you in respect to our relationship. If their self-awareness is very low, it's going to be hard to make progress because they don't see it, get it, know it. It's going to be difficult to have those type of relationships. But, you know, self-awareness is a primary behavior that people need in order to drive their career.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it would be hard, though, I think, if you were working for someone who was a bit of a narcissist.
Yeah, everybody has a story. You know, I've worked for people who were fantastic to work for, and I've worked for people who were very hard to work for. Sometimes it was personality conflicts that, you know, the way I did things and the way they did things just were different. But we never had the conversation around, hey, you think of things this way, I think of things this way, you know, how can we come together? How can we make this work? Instead, you know, we fought about it, right? Or we just never were on the same page and it became the baggage of the relationship, right? So every time a topic came up or every time we needed to solve something, we both came at it different ways.
Yeah, it's butted heads all the time. Yeah, I've worked in places like that. I've butted heads with the boss constantly because we were just two different personalities and it just, we didn't have the conversation to say, you know, where can we go to, you know, find an equal plane. So, yeah, so, you know, I ended up leaving because I just couldn't work there any longer.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's, you know, that's where drive your career comes into play, which is if I am having a relationship that's difficult. So knowing yourself is important. Having a good relationship with your boss is important. If I need to work on that relationship, looking for ways to improve it are critical. And certainly personality preferences are a great way to build self-awareness on, you know, what do I bring to the table? How do I operate as a leader? How do you operate as a leader? Where are the gaps, and what can we do to close those gaps? If we're not doing that, you know, it's never going to get better.
No. Well, you might leave your book alone for a little bit and talk a bit about your podcast, if that's okay. Can you, just tell us what it's called, what it's about, and, you know, who your guests are?
Absolutely. It's called Be Brave at Work, and it's available everywhere. And I started it in the fall of 2019. And it really came from a initial observation I had, again, in my work with clients, that everyone, and, you know, I do use the word everyone because I believe this happens to all of us at some point in our career, we could have been braver in what we said or what we did than we were. And there are stories that people tell where they were brave and the positive impact that that had on their career. And there are stories people tell that they look back on where they didn't show bravery. And even today, years later, the regret they feel about not saying something they could have said or not do something that they could have done. So the goal of the podcast is to have people come on, and it's everyone from experts in psychological safety and team management to everyday average people talking about what their interpretations are of bravery in the workplace, and really leaving with, you know, one or two ideas that people can take to help them make good progress. I'm not suggesting we can solve your particular specific issue, but if we can give you an idea or provide you the momentum in order to make progress, that's a huge win. And so, you know, my hope in the podcast, Rose, is to ensure that listeners get inspired in respect to a topic that they have at work that they really feel they need to be braver in order to do something and do it. And you always want to be respectful. You always want to be courteous. But sometimes you have to say something or do something that takes bravery. And that's what we hope to talk about.
Yeah, I've been, even in personal relationships, you know, you think, oh, God, I wish I had said that, or, you know, I wish I hadn't have said that. Quite often it's me. I've got my foot in my mouth more times than not. But,
we have all felt that. And you're right. It's not just professional. The angle of the podcast is professional, but it applies personally. You might have a situation with a neighbor, you might have a situation with a child or a parent that you've been avoiding. And we all have, you know, I'll say almost all of us have conversations that we are avoiding because we don't have the bravery as one of the reasons to do something about it. So, again, I haven't studied it, but my experience both as a professional worker in corporations in America, as well as a leadership coach, everyone I've worked with needs to say something or do something that they have not done. And one of the key factors of that is the absence of bravery to do it.
Yeah, I think we could all deal with it every now and again, especially now in the world, way the world is. Some of us just aren't brave enough to stand up and say our 2 cents worth, and because we're too frightened to of the backlash that we probably perceive is going to happen, but it may not. But, you know, right. We've got these ideas that, you know, it's going to cause trouble or it's going to hurt someone's feelings or whatever. So yeah, I totally get it.
Yeah, and look, I think you're like most other people, and I believe in your country, and I will tell you, in my country, at no time in junior high or high school or college did we ever get trained or taught on how to handle conflict or how to be brave. And it's just a life behavior that I guess you're supposed to learn. And of course, you don't learn it at all. And then you're plopped into a leadership role. And now the first thing you have to do is say things that are hard to say or do things that are hard to do that require bravery. And so it becomes frustrating or aggravating or irritating because I'm like, all right, well, how do I do this? Or what's the right thing to say? Or where do I start? I don't know, right? So again, that's what we hope people get from the podcast, are ideas and pieces of information they can use to say, oh, that might be a great way to start. Let me think about that as a platform in order to work from. Because again, I believe all of us need to be braver in the workplace. And almost none of us have ever been taught or trained how to do it.
No, I totally agree. You know, sometimes you just get shoved into a leadership role without even, you know, and no one thinks, well, you know, is this person ready to go into a leadership role in the first place? You know, they do great work and everything, but, you know, are they emotionally able to cope with, you know, the upgrade in position? It's sometimes, you know, it's not horses for courses. It's just, you know, shove you in there and hope for the best.
Yeah, that's what it is. That's exactly what it is. It's like, all right, good luck. And there you are. And you don't know what to do or how to do it. And the other challenge for bravery in the workplace is culture. And most organizations don't explicitly say that we want to be brave with each other. You know, I believe bravery is about helping others be better, not being judgmental, not being critical, not trying to hurt their feelings, but you're trying to help them be experienced by others in better ways. And so, you know, organizations need to get better at stating, encouraging, rewarding, role modeling acts of bravery so we can be better, right? If you lived in a world where someone could come to you and without judgment and without hurting your feelings, tell you something that you think you need to know in order to be better, you'd welcome it. Absolutely. I may or may not do what it is that you're saying, but, you know, certainly if you're observing something you think I could be doing differently, come tell me. Unfortunately, that's not the world that we're in. And so we avoid being brave because we're more afraid of what you were saying, hurting, frustrating, it not coming out well. There's something called relational energy, which is the energy we get from building good relationships. You know, when someone walks into an office or to a room who has positive energy, the room feels better, right? I'm sure you can think of people who, oh, thank God Rose is here, right? This is going to be so much better. And there are others who don't have positive energy, right?
Oh, the energy, and they drain, they suck the life out of you. Yeah.
Yeah, when they walk in the room. So, you know, this is about helping each other be better at work.
Yeah. Okay. So, and where can people find you?
So I would encourage folks to go to my website, which is excellius.com, excellius.com. There's a ton of information about the podcast, about the books, and about the work that I do as a leadership and a team coach.
Perfect. And the book is available everywhere?
It is available everywhere, especially on Amazon and Barnes & Noble. So if the three topics I talked about are of interest, you know, certainly I encourage folks to go out and buy the book.
Absolutely. Okay, Ed. Well, thank you so much for rejoining me today. I really appreciated you coming back on. And hopefully we'll get to chat again when you write your next book.
You're on. I'll be here.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you.